is something that I used to do when I was 19 years old. He shifted me all the way back to when I was 19. And I cannot recall, not that I haven't laid prostrate in the floor before God to pray and things like that, but when I was 19, there were days I would go and lay in my floor literally for hours, or even I would fall asleep at night in the middle of my living room floor on a blanket, on a pallet, with my Bible in front of me and my notepad. And literally, that's what God has done to me this week. And He still has not quite released me from it. I've literally been on my living room floor, not in my bed, but in my living room floor with my Bible in front of me and my notepad. And I want to tell you that God's been talking. And the thing is, that's why I say I appreciate the fact that you all are able to receive the word however it comes, and you're not putting a demand tonight to just shout, because I believe if I give you the right word, you'll be shouting for the whole year.
Yes. Amen.
If I give you what God said, you'll be able to shout through the whole year.
Yes. Amen.
So that's what this night is about. This night is a very important night. As we get ready to move into this new year, let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray tonight that as I go into this word, that you would touch your people, move on their hearts to receive what you would say to us tonight. God, give me the tongue of the wise, the tongue of the learned, that I can declare your oracles, and the word of the Lord will come alive to the hearts of the people. In Jesus' name, and everyone said,
amen.
Amen. Exodus chapter number 13, I'm going to read a couple of verses from there, and then we're going to go to Exodus chapter number 14. In Exodus chapter 13, we're going to look at verses 17 and 18, and then we're going to turn the page to Exodus chapter 14, and we're going to read from there. If you have Exodus 13, would you say amen? If you have the ability to stand for just a few moments for the reading of the word, I'd be honored if you would. We want to honor the word of God tonight. It says, and it came to pass when Pharaoh had let the people go, that God led them not through the way of the land of the Philistines, although that was near. For God said, lest perhaps the people repent when they see war and they return to Egypt. But God led the people about through the way of the wilderness of the Red Sea. And the children of Israel went up harnessed out of the land of Egypt. Now let's go to chapter number 14. It's going to be a little extensive, but just stay with me for a moment. Verse number 1 says, and the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, speak to the children of Israel that they turn and encamp before Pi-Hahiroth, between Migdol and the sea, and over against Baal-Zephon, and before it ye shall encamp by the sea. For Pharaoh will say of the children, they are entangled in the land, the wilderness has shut them in. And I will harden Pharaoh's heart, and he shall follow after them, and I will be honored upon Pharaoh and upon all his hosts, that the Egyptians may know that I am the Lord. And they did so. And it was told the king of Egypt that the people fled, and the heart of Pharaoh and his servants was turned against the people. And they said, why have we done this, that we have let Israel go from serving us? And he made ready his chariot and took his people with him, and took 600 chosen chariots, all the chariots of Egypt, and captains over every one of them. And the Lord hardened the heart of Pharaoh, king of Egypt. And he pursued after the children of Israel, and the children of Israel went out with a high hand. But the Egyptians pursued after them, all the horses and chariots of Pharaoh and his horsemen and his army overtook them, encamping by the sea, beside Pi-Hahiroth, before Baal-Zephon. And when Pharaoh drew nigh, the children of Israel lifted up their eyes, and behold, the Egyptians marched after them, and they were sore afraid. And the children of Israel cried out unto the Lord. And they said unto Moses, because there were no graves in Egypt, have you taken us away to die in the wilderness? Why have you dealt with us this way to carry us out of Egypt? Is not this the word that we did tell thee in Egypt, saying, leave us alone, that we may serve the Egyptians? For it had been better for us to serve the Egyptians than we should die in the wilderness. And Moses said unto the people, fear not, stand still and see the salvation of the Lord, which he will show to you today. For the Egyptians you have seen today, you shall see them again no more. What? Forever. The Lord shall fight. Oh God. I can shout right there. The Lord shall fight for you, and you shall hold your peace. And the Lord said unto Moses, why are you crying to me? Speak to the children of Israel that they go forward. But lift thou up thy rod and stretch out thy hand over the sea and divide it. And the children of Israel shall go on dry ground through the midst of the sea. Now, go down to verse number 21. And Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and the Lord caused the sea to go back by a strong east wind all that night, and made the sea dry land, and the waters were divided. And the children of Israel went into the midst of the sea upon the dry ground, and the waters were a wall unto them on their left hand and on their right hand. And the Egyptians pursued and went in after them to the midst of the sea, even all Pharaoh's horses, his chariots, and his horsemen. And it came to pass that in the morning watch, the Lord looked into the host of the Egyptians through a pillar of fire and troubled the host of the Egyptians, and took off their chariot wheels and drove them heavily, so that the Egyptians said, let us flee from the face of Israel, for the Lord fights for them. And the Lord said, Moses, stretch your hand out over the sea, that the waters may come again upon the Egyptians, upon their chariots, and upon their horsemen. And Moses stretched his hand, and the sea returned to its strength. When the morning appeared, and the Egyptians fled against it, and the Lord overthrew the Egyptians in the midst of the sea. Verse 29, but the children of Israel walked upon dry land in the midst of the sea, and the water was a wall unto them on their right hand, on their left. Thus the Lord saved Israel that day out of the hands of the Egyptians. And Israel saw the Egyptians dead upon the seashore. I want to just use for a thought today the year of strategic victory.
All right. Amen.
Would you look on your way down and tell somebody 2017?
2017
will be
the year of strategic victory.
Sister Brenda, on the microphone that I'm on, if you could just, on the highest moment, you could take it down just slightly, you can be seated in the presence of the Lord. I have been looking over the course of the last few days, ladies and gentlemen, and as I've been looking at social media, I've watched people talk about the incoming of this new year.
Uh-huh.
I've watched people talk about the fact that this year, they are excited about the going out of this year. They are hyped up about 2016 being on its way out the door.
Uh-huh.
And they're excited about it, the fact that it's closing and now we're moving into a brand new year. That's a little bit too much, Sister Brenda, take it back to just before it was being back, if you will. Hallelujah. But what happens is people have looked at the change of a clock or of a calendar as if it is some superstitious transition. That simply because the calendar changes to 2017,
yes,
or because the clock changes to 12:00 from 11:59, uh-huh, that something all of a sudden is going to change.
Yes. Uh-huh.
It goes without saying that if you do not change,
uh-huh,
and I do not change, then we will see the consistency of the things that happened in the years past.
Yes.
Yes.
If we don't begin to adjust some things,
uh-huh,
we will be in a position next year this time saying the same thing. Uh-huh. I can't wait until 2017 goes out.
Uh-huh.
And 2018 comes in. The Lord began to speak to me, ladies and gentlemen. He began to say, and I needed to tell the people tonight, that before you walk out of here, even when you're on your way home, you need to do some examination of your life and ask yourself this question: am I in the same place I was in this time last year?
Yes.
Now, if we look at ourselves, we, you know, the first person, no, I'm not the same person. I've had new experiences, I'm different, I've been changed. That's what we automatically say. But if we look at the holistic view of ourselves, many times we are pretty much the same people doing the same things we've always done. We're still afraid to try new stuff. No, I'm not talking. Still afraid to do things that you've not done before. Still afraid to step out on faith for what God has challenged you to do. Still afraid to make moves in God. But tonight I didn't just come to speak to your spiritual. I came to speak to both your spiritual and your natural. Because some of us have been afraid, okay, you've got the compulsion to go back to school, but because you feel like you're too old to go back to school, you've been afraid to step out and do it.
Yes.
Hello, somebody.
Yes.
Or whatever this thing might be that God has told you to do, and you struggled with it, and so now you're in the same place this year that you were last year. God told you to adjust the way you eat. And you have not adjusted the way you eat. You started off well, but you didn't keep going. God told you to change your exercise habits. And you, because it started to hurt a little bit, you said, no, I'm good. And you went back on your exercise plan. I can't get a call from that church. What's wrong? It's quiet right about now. But that's the reality of where we are. So we look at ourselves and we still, we talk about, well, I want to be healthier and I want to lose weight. And we still weigh the same thing we weighed last year. Or more. I mean, it's okay to laugh at the church, but it's the reality. Because we've not maintained. The Lord said to me, he said, tell the people, we've got to go back and evaluate our lives. Take a look at ourselves this year. See what you have accomplished and what you haven't accomplished.
Yes.
And once you have looked at yourself and seen what you have and you have not accomplished, I'm not telling you to make a resolution, because resolutions are easily broken.
That's right.
I'm telling you, you've got to make a decision.
Uh-huh.
I can't hear nobody right there.
Yes.
I am saying you've got to make a decision. If things are going to be better in 20, now there are things you can't control. Let's be real. There's things you can't control. But the things that you can control, you ought to take control of. Oh, y'all not gonna work with me here. But you got to understand, it is imperative. You were given, you were assigned to have authority. So the things that you were supposed to take control of, you need to be taking control of. Otherwise, you're going to keep on living defeated.
Yes.
You're going to still be going to the same doctors.
Uh-huh.
Oh. You'll be still going to the same doctors about the same high blood pressure, but you're still pouring salt in your food.
Preach.
You'll be still going to the same doctors about the diabetes medicine because you're still piling on your sodas and your...
That's right.
Oh, God, I'm in trouble. It's 2016 going into 2017. I might as well tell the truth and upset the
folks. Preach, Evelyn.
If we're going to do this thing, God wants us, let me just talk practically, God wants us in good health. He wants us in a position where we can be able to do something for the kingdom. We're always tired.
Yes.
Always worn out, along so drained. Our joints are hurting, not because we've gotten old. Uh-oh, I can't hear nobody right here. But because we've eaten so much and gained so much weight that we're putting pressure on our knees and pressure on our back. Y'all might not want to face Facebook Live. I'm going to make some folks mad in social media. But the reality is, this coming year, what would happen if you began to feel better because you made changes?
Yes.
Here's the second thing God began to deal with me about. If you're taking notes, this is number two. God said to me, the place, watch this. He said, what happens is we reach forward and then we draw back at the place of our limitation. We reach forward, but we draw back at the place of our limitation. What if the man with the withered hand, y'all remember him, don't you?
Yeah.
Not another day.
Yeah.
With a hand. What if he could only lift his arm this high?
Uh-huh.
And when Jesus said, stretch out, all he did was got here. And when he got here,
uh-huh,
he met the point of his limitation and said, no, that's all right. What if the woman who ran into the prophet Elijah had said, she started baking the cake after the man of God told her, bake me a cake first. What if she had started baking that cake and said, I'm really going to be out of food if I do this. No, that's all right. Me and my son going to eat this and die. How many of us have reached out just far enough to hit the place of our limitations and then drawn back? Am I talking to anybody?
Oh, yes.
It's a hard thing when you are that person who hits your point of limitation and then you
drawn
back. I find it interesting that even runners, when they're running, they have this thing called hitting the wall. When you run hard enough, they call hitting the wall. That's the place where you feel like you're about to give out. You have no, any runners, anybody used to run track in high school, know what I'm talking about? You would hit that spot, you'd be running, and all of a sudden your breath's in when it goes out, your legs get weak, everything. And you ready to quit, and in that moment your coach says, keep going.
Yes.
Y'all know what I'm talking about. Your coach says, keep going. And you say, well, I don't have the strength to keep going. You hit the place of your limitation. I come to tell you, if you don't keep running past the place of your limitation, you will never get strong enough to make it to the finish line.
Yeah, yeah.
And where we have been is we've always gone just far enough, but we've never pressed past the place of our limitation. So we've been stuck in the same place. We keep starting over and running again, but we're always stuck because we never press past our limitation. The danger is sometimes the limitation has been your mindset.
Yes.
Oh God.
Come on.
Yes.
The danger has been your mindset. I was looking in the book of Genesis the other day, around chapter 30. This messed me up. He said, it was a story about Jacob. Now watch this, and I don't know who this is for, but I hear God right now. Jacob, he had made a deal with his uncle Laban. And he says, allow me to just have the speckled flock. And in that day, the speckled flock represented, quote unquote, the weaker flock. He said, let me have the weaker flock. The speckled flock. And what Jacob did, Jacob was in a period of time where he was tending to Laban's flocks. And he separated all of the solid colored animals. But stay with me for just a moment. He separated out all the solid colored animals. And he would bring them to the trough to drink and to eat. But what Jacob did was something very profound. If you look at Genesis chapter 30, you'll see it for yourself. He took them and he cut the bark of a tree that had speckles in it.
Mm-hmm.
And put the tree, the branches in the trough. So that while they were eating, they had to look at the speckled branches.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh.
I'm going somewhere. They had to look at the speckled branches. But what made this so profound, ladies and gentlemen, is that when these solid colored animals would mate, because of what they saw in the trough, the speckled branches that were in the trough, when they saw it, the Bible said they produced speckled offspring.
Yes, yes. Uh-huh. Yes.
Oh. What are you trying to say, Elder? I'm trying to tell you that what you have allowed into your eye gate and into your ear gate, what you have seen, what you have heard, what you have lived, what you have watched from your family line, what you have watched on TV, what you listen to on the radio, what you live in your life, it has shaped your way of thinking.
Yes, yes.
You're so used to living around broke folks.
Yeah.
That the power back and not act on the power that had been deposited in their life.
Yes.
talk to me and hear all that. It wasn't enough for them for God to say, here you go, here's life back into you. At some point, Abraham and Sarah had to go exercise what God had now put in them.
Yes, yes. Can I
give y'all a little insight?
Yes.
The Bible never tells us how many times Abraham and Sarah had to try or had to do what they had to do before Isaac came. It never gives us an indicator of how many times. And so the thing is, what if, I'm just giving a hypothetical, what if she didn't get pregnant on the first go-round? What if she didn't get pregnant on the second go-round? What if she, and see, most of us, because we don't see it happen in the first couple of times, we feel like we're just going to go ahead and give up. But obviously, it must be like it used to be. But I come to tell you today that God has to pray. It is not like it used to be. Something shifted in your life. Break through the limitation if they don't fight.
Yes.
Thank y'all for helping.
telling them to preach. So we're telling them these words, and then we don't even know that we've heard God telling them to take their hands off. Or vice versa. We're telling them to put their hands in when God's saying, take your hands off. I will not change my message. I've been preaching this for the last 3 years. That is why it is imperative that each of us has an intimate relationship with God, because the only way you're going to know when to take your hands off and when to put your hands on is if you have an ear that is inclined to the heart of God. If your ear is inclined to him, you're not going to know what to do.
That's right.
You're going to be making guesses. This is not the season for you to be guessing.
Amen. No, it's not.
Because God says, I'm about to give you a strategic victory. I'm almost done, believe it or not. I'm almost there. God says, this is the year. Somebody say that with me. This is the year.
This is the year.
Of the strategic.
Of the strategic.
Of the strategic victory. God has purposed the strategic victory. Now, I very deliberately use the words that I use tonight, ladies and gentlemen, because it's not just going to be victory. It's got to be a strategic. Come on, talk to me right now. It's not just victory. It is. It's not just victory, it is
strategic.
It is so urgent that we understand that this is a strategic victory.
Yes.
Because without the right strategy, you are destined for defeat.
Yes.
You know, thank you, Holy Ghost. Wars are not generally fought for no reason. Just walk with me for a moment. They don't fight wars for no reason. Generally, wars are fought because, number one, one people group or another feels disrespected. Or as if someone is taking advantage of them or taking what belongs to them. So they declare war because they're fighting back. The other reason why wars take place, generally speaking, is because some land or another wants to take over the other land.
Yeah.
Am I making sense, y'all?
Yeah.
It's either one or the other. If you're trying to take my land, I declare war because I'm not letting you have my land. If I'm trying to take your land, I'm declaring war because I want this land.
Mm-hmm.
I come to declare to some believers tonight that what God has declared to you is this is the year of strategic victory. But get this, it's not because you were on the defense, but this year you got to be on the offense.
Yeah.
We got to be on the offense. This is the time where we've got to be in a forceful advance. Tell the enemy, I'm taking what's mine.
Where are the people in this room tonight who will say to the enemy, I'm taking
what's mine.
What's mine?
Yes.
Okay. Now let me move to my close. I'm taking what's mine. So there was a promise given to Abraham more than 400 years prior that his seed was going to inherit Canaan. They were going to be blessed with a land that was flowing with milk and honey. The promised land. Right? The interesting thing is, between that promise and the going in was Egypt. A holding place. Oh, I can shout right here. If y'all stay with me, you'll see why I don't shout. Because the Bible says it was Joseph who was in Egypt, who was the, he said, y'all know he was the dreamer
right,
and the interpreter of dreams.
And because of him being able to interpret dreams, he saved all of his family. Y'all remember that, right? His whole family got saved as a result of him being a dream interpreter. He was promoted to the second in command of the country. And so his family was preserved because he was promoted, because he walked into what God ordained him to be. But watch this. Over time, his relatives, they moved there to Egypt. The Pharaoh that was alive at that time honored Joseph. But the Bible says in the beginning of the chapter, it says, and there arose a Pharaoh that did not know Joseph. Joseph died. Come on, y'all walk with me right here. Joseph died. And there came a Pharaoh that did not know or did not honor Joseph.
Yes.
And so watch this. And then it goes on. So this blessed me right here. It says, and the people of God, and he decided that he was going to put them in bondage. And the people of God grew.
Y'all missed it. Okay, let me go back again.
Promise to Abraham. Between the promise and the provision, there was an Egypt. Yeah. Y'all get upset about your Egypt.
Yeah.
Y'all get upset about the bondage you had to walk through. Uh-huh. But the fact is, it was the bondage that produced the growth of the people. Because the Bible said that the Pharaoh got nervous and put even more pressure on them because he saw that they were expanding and that they were growing. God had to put you in some places that you didn't want to go in this year. You were not even complaining about what you had to go through. You needed a shadow work because in that it pressed something in you that made you expand.
Yes.
But Elder, you don't know how much trouble I've been going through. Maybe they went through the wilderness for a period of 40 years. But when they got through going through their wilderness, guess what? They still got what God said. And when God gave them what he said he was going to give them, they were able to shout over what they got.
Yes.
Yes.
I'm making sense tonight.
Yes. Uh-huh.
So, here's the thing. They go out. And the Bible specifically says in chapter 14, they went out with a high hand.
Uh-huh.
So a couple more points I need to give you. Number one. Next point. I asked God, I said, God, how did Moses know which way to go? And that bothered me. Ladies and gentlemen, that really bothered me because I'm like, you know, how did he know which way to go that would lead him to the Red Sea? And why would he go to the Red Sea? And we found that in chapter 13.
Uh-huh.
It says, and God led them. Isn't that what we read? And God led them. But watch this. Watch closely in the text. It says, but he did not take them by way of the Philistines, which was closer for them. Isn't that what it says in the text?
Yes.
It says, he could have taken them, verse 17, 18. I could have taken them the closer way. Some of y'all have been frustrated, and that's the reason why you've been giving up. Because you feel like you've been going the long way around. You may feel like you've been going the long way around this process.
Yes, yes.
But this thing was necessary because if I took you the near way, you were going to have to deal with warfare that you shouldn't have to deal with, and that you went to knowledge you shouldn't have to deal with, that you weren't ready for. God knows how to die. See, we complain about the fact that we're on the long way around, but sometimes God is leading you around to warfare that you weren't ready for. But if you didn't get that warfare, you would have given up. You would have gone in the towel. You would have said, God, I quit. I'm going back to Egypt. But you, God had to take him a long way around, so he could bring you the way he wanted to go. He had to bring you the long way around, so you wouldn't quit. He had to bring you the long way around. He would have prayed for the long way. You wanted when you wanted?
Yes.
Oh, I can't even help it.
Yes.
If he had given you the husband that you thought was supposed to be your husband,
oh
come on, somebody talk to me here. If he had given you the wife that you thought was supposed to be your wife, where would you be right now? You might be back in the clubs again. You might be back in drinking and smoking again. You might be torn up on the floor. But because God took you the long way around, that's why you might not be with somebody like that. Had to wait.
My God.
Uh-huh. Had to wait.
Yes.
Jesus.
Because he's trying to set you up.
Yes.
Set me up, Lord.
My.
Woo!
Jesus.
I'm about to go in up here.
Uh-huh.
See, y'all don't understand.
Uh-huh.
He also was setting you up
yes.
to show you a miracle.
Yes.
Yeah. Somebody ought to remember Sunday's message. Somebody ought to remember that Sunday's message. When you had stuff going on behind the scenes. The curtain was down. Dark. Looked like nothing was going on. There's a reason for it. He was set the stage for a miracle.
Yeah.
Watch. How do I know? Because if he sent me and drove me in the direction of the Red Sea, obviously he already promised where I was going.
Uh-huh. Yes.
Obviously, if I had mountains on the left, mountains on the right,
uh-huh.
Red Sea in front of me,
yes.
and Pharaoh behind me. Obviously,
yes.
he was setting me up
uh-huh.
for a miracle.
Yes.
If he took me the long way around,
uh-huh.
through the wilderness,
yes.
with all that stuff on my back, mm.
He had a plan to give me a miracle. He had a plan to show me, oh, I must have had a church right here, to show me a new aspect of him that I've never seen before. Obviously, he had a plan to show me, oh, wait a minute, to give me another reason to praise him.
Come out right.
Yeah. And I offended some folks, not because of my insecurities and my weaknesses. But that really wasn't my heart.
Yes, yes.
Right. Okay, watch this. And when she said that to me, I stood there. The tears began to well up in my eyes. Because I had to finally come to grips with the history of a demonic stronghold that has had me for years. Had me for years. I struggled for years. I had to fight with it. I had to tell her, Sister Paul, I apologize. I didn't mean to offend you. It's not that I don't trust you. I said, but I've been disappointed so many times before. You've been disappointed so many times before. Let down broken. So you do whatever you can to try. I said, but I give you my word, I'm going to take my hands off of it. And if you see me trying to get back to involved, just tell the elder back up. And I respect it. Because I'm a work in progress. Just because I hold this mic and wear a collar does not mean I got this thing all right. There's still
history.
Trying to chase me down.
Yes.
I will never learn. Watch this. Oh God. So I'm on the phone this week. Can I really testify?
Yes.
I'm talking to a friend of mine. And my friend said, you know, and we were talking about something else. I was explaining how, and as a matter of fact, I said, I thank God for Bishop and First Lady. They invited me over to eat for Christmas and so on and so forth. And the other saints, they blessed me with plates. I said, but I'm going to tell you this. If I can help it, I'm not going to be in Knoxville, Tennessee next year at Christmas time. And they were like, why? I said, wasn't anything against the people that did anything. Thank God for them. Thank you. But something on the inside of me, when I go home,
that's right.
The hugs, the love, the words of affirmation, refuel me and give me the strength to come back here and do what I do. And so when I didn't go home at that time when my family was gathered, I had to kind of regroup. And my friend said to me, she said, I never realized that your love language is words of affirmation and physical touch. And I said, wow, I never thought about it like that. And I said, well, why didn't you think that? She said, because you're so guarded. I don't know why God's got me here right now, but I need to give this because this is going to help somebody for 2017.
Yes.
She said, because you're so guarded. I said, well, how am I guarded? She said, you don't let people in very easily. You keep people at arm's distance. You're afraid to let people close to you. I said, yeah, you're right. I had to come. And then she wasn't the only one that told me that. It came back again and again. And I realized in that moment that more than one person is saying the same thing to you. It's because God is trying to come after that thing in your life. He's trying to move you out of where you've been. I don't know who I'm talking to, but somebody in this room, you may not have the same testimony that I have, but you've been feeling some similar situations in your life. And God's been dealing, in this last closing season of the year, God's been dealing with you about areas of your life where your history is trying to catch up with you. In church, we tend to think, my sister, we tend to think when we talk about sexual sin and physical sin. No, I'm not talking about just that right now. That can be a case too. I'm not talking about that.
Yes, Jesus.
There's some demonic strongholds. The memory of a marriage that went bad.
Yes, Lord.
Can keep you from walking in what God has for you now.
Yes.
Okay. Let me move to close this thing. So here's where they were. They had behind them the demonic trying to chase them down. Their history coming after them. Then on the left and on the right, they had hard places.
Come on, y'all with me tonight?
Yes.
Mountains, they had hard places. Anybody in here, look to your left, look to your right, you got some
hard places.
So some of us are left wondering right now, I got hard places to my left and to my right. Are you going to split the mountains? How are you going to get 600,000 people across those mountains? Are you going to split the mountains and let me walk through? God says, I'm not moving the hard places. Get ready to shout right here. He said, what I'm going to do is I'm going to move the fluid places.
Yes, Lord.
Did y'all hear what I said? He said, I'm getting ready to move the fluid places. Y'all know what fluid means. That's stuff that's movable. Here's the thing. Watch this. This don't mess me up. When God gave a talk to me today, he said, listen. He said, son, but the thing about the fluid places, it's a place where you can't get a grip. Because you reach down in some water, you ain't going to be able to hold on to that water. You can't pull the water out. You can't move it. But it is an impossible situation. Some of us, we got some stuff, but we can't get a grip.
For you to stretch out.
Yes.
Oh, watch this. Stretch out.
Yes.
With what you got in your hand.
Yes.
You can cook, cook. Those of y'all that do hair, learn some new techniques. So you can get even stronger.
Yes.
Get more clients.
Uh-huh.
So God can bless you.
Uh-huh.
Find a way to learn how to teach the class.
Uh-huh. Yes.
I can't hear nobody.
Yeah.
You don't have to just be the person that's always doing hair. What if you get your skills to teach the class? How much more would you be blessed if you are a teacher at the school of beauty? See, God wants to bless you, but you got to use what's in your hand.
Then God said, tell the people, move forward. Move forward. When you see the east wind blow, northeast wind blow, and it opens up the sea strong enough that it dries up the ground and y'all can go all the way across. Don't stand there and look at it. I can hear nobody.
Yeah.
I just said something right there. But yeah, when God opens the door for a miracle, don't stand there and look at it.
Yeah.
Oh, wow. That's not the moment to stand there and look at it. That's the moment to move.
Yeah.
Right.
So, here it is. The last thing God sent me here to tell you tonight, and I need you all to hear me very clearly. He said, tell them, don't miss their window of opportunity.
Yes.
I'm going to prophesy right here. And you can write this down and take it to the bank that I'm telling the truth.
Uh-huh.
This year, we'll present you with a number of supernatural opportunities.
Amen.
Windows,
yes,
of opportunity,
yes,
are going to be supernaturally released in your life this year. And you have to be ready for the windows.
Mm-hmm.
It will be sad for God to open the windows. How the scripture says, pour you out of the windows. You will have room for seed.
Mm-hmm.
Wouldn't it be sad, Sister Rosalind, if God opens the window of opportunity for you and you don't take advantage of it?
Yeah.
Can I tell you a secret? Now, just watch this, ladies and gentlemen. Watch this. You can write a song today and not do what you're supposed to do with the song. Leave it on the shelf. Just write it, sing it, but never do anything with it. 5 years from now, you can go back and look at that song. And you may try to bring that song out, and it won't work.
Yes.
Because by 5 years from now, the music genres have changed. Some of my seasons, as y'all know, R&B doesn't sound like the R&B of old.
That's right.
So if you try to bring that old R&B back the way it was, it's not going to work.
Uh-huh.
You at least have to have something in it that freshens it up,
yes,
to make it fit the season that we're in.
That's right.
But if you miss your window of opportunity, you can miss out on the blessing.
Yes. Uh-huh.
Am I making sense?
Yes.
I can't afford to miss my windows of opportunity this year.
Uh-huh.
Don't miss your windows of opportunity. So listen, here's what you got to do. Remember I said it's a strategic victory? Moving forward, stretching out, but not missing the windows of opportunity when they open is a part of the strategy. Okay? Got to do that. Because if you miss it, you may never get the chance again. Here's the problem. We're selfish in church.
Yes.
So we think if I miss it, I just miss it. There's a problem with that. If Moses had not stepped forward and commanded the people to go forward, they would have been captured by the Israelites.
Yes.
There are people that are coming up behind you that will be entrapped by history if you don't take advantage of the window.
Lord Jesus, y'all not talking.
If you miss your window, your kids could miss their blessing. What if you're supposed to be the next Duncan Hines? And that causes you to prosper so financially that everything is wonderful and your children have an inheritance. But because you don't do what you're supposed to do, they miss everything. See, we think about ourselves, we don't think about everybody else. So, ladies and gentlemen, this is going to be the year, mark this down, of the strategic victory. Now, you're going to hear a lot of different things all over the internet, all over TV, of people declaring what this year is. I stand as the prophet of this house under Bishop Wright, and I declare what the Lord has said concerning those of you that are here tonight.
Amen.
For you, because you were here tonight, this is your year of a strategic victory. You will have to do something to see it happen. But you will get victory.
Amen.
Everybody say it. Who was this word for tonight?
Amen.
Did somebody get something? Did it speak to
you? Yes.